It's the last day for Americans to sign up for the new health insurance exchanges in this first year of the program, and there was plenty of demand. There were also more glitches and problems. But in stark contrast to the launch last fall, hundreds of thousands have been able to sign up in recent days, and the system seemed more resilient than in October.
The healthcare.gov website bent under a last-minute crush of traffic, more than 125,000 users at any given moment. The site was out of service for almost 4 hours this morning, and it briefly went down again in the afternoon.
I can't believe this is actually working.
Yeah, it works very well.
Some last-minute applicants sought out help centers around the country. This woman signed up for coverage in Arlington, Virginia.
It's going to save us thousands of dollars. Thousands of dollars a year. In terms of like where our prescription, you know, his prescription is going to be covered, we're going to, our monthly payment is considerably less. We're getting better coverage.
Others were frustrated. One Texas woman said she gave up trying to enroll online.
It was just a mess on there, like page after page, and it never got me to where I needed to be. So I was like, I'm giving up on this and I'm just going to go here.
As the day began, more than 6 million people had signed up through the federal and state-run exchanges. That's about a million shy of the original goal. Estimates from some insurers show 80% of those applicants had paid their premiums. In addition, more than 4 million people will be eligible for coverage through Medicaid. At the White House today, Press Secretary Jay Carney painted a picture of success.
We're achieving something today that I know has our critics gnashing their teeth. I know it leaves them with, the need to go back to the drawing board when it comes to other means of trying to attack a law that is providing opportunity and security to millions of Americans.
But Senator Lindsey Graham and other Republicans insisted again, the health care law is unworkable. He tweeted, "You have to tear it down and start over." In the meantime, enrollments aren't done just yet. The administration is granting extensions to anyone who says personal issues or technical problems prevented their completing the process.
And we look at some of the many questions being asked today. We're joined again by Mary Agnes Carey of Kaiser Health News and Susan Dentzer, a health analyst for the NewsHour. Welcome back to the program.
It's great to be with you, Jim.
So, Susan, what's the very latest on what's happened today? We know people were madly signing up. At least some were madly signing up. What were the final numbers?
We don't know the actual final numbers for today, but we do know that the Department of Health and Human Services says that 1.6 million visits were made to healthcare.gov, the federal health insurance website, and that more than 800,000 calls were placed to call centers. And that, of course, leaves out what happened in the state exchanges. And we know that there are 14 state-based exchanges, and then, of course, the exchange in the District of Columbia. We don't know what the numbers were there, but it's quite conceivable that potentially another million people have signed up in the past few days.
So for anybody who's watching who hasn't signed up, who wants to sign up, how much time do they have? What's the penalty if they don't?
Well, right now, you can go on the website if you're enrolling through the federal exchange and check a box saying that you want to get on. You'll get an email potentially later today. We already know the administration has said if you've had difficulty enrolling to date, you have at least until the middle of April to enroll. And then we have these special enrollment periods that where people with various other circumstances will be able to enroll. And there's no outside deadline that's been set on that yet. So it could be we'll be getting more enrollment for the next several months. The other important thing to point out is that anybody who wants to sign up for Medicaid who's eligible can sign up at any point. So Medicaid enrollment will continue throughout the year.
No deadline on that. Mary Agnes Carey, the whole purpose of this in the beginning, or at least a large part of the purpose, was to get people who didn't have health insurance to get covered. How, in terms of the big picture, how's that going?
Well, it's going fairly well from the administration's point of view. The deadline, the goal, rather, of 6 million was hit last week. They're hoping they can get more folks enrolled. But I think a key test here is the affordability question. Do people find the premiums affordable? How about their co-pays? They're out of their out-of-pocket expenses, that sort of thing, the deductibles. That seems to be the real test that we have to keep looking at to see if it works.
And what are you finding about that? I mean, what are you hearing? I know you've been reporting on this for months now. Are you finding, I mean, is the preponderance of evidence that people are saying, you know, this isn't as bad as I thought, it isn't as expensive, or what are you hearing?
It's kind of all over the map. I mean, it really varies depending on where you live. How competitive is the marketplace where you live? How many insurers want to get involved? What are the prices that the local hospitals and physicians are charging? How does that impact the negotiations? And there's variance. For example, our reporters found out in Philadelphia, you might pay 77% more for a policy if you're a 40-year-old man than if you got that same policy in Pittsburgh. Now, the subsidies can help with that cost, but in Georgia, for example, prices can double in one part of the state versus another. We found a rural Georgia town where the premiums were actually more expensive than Beverly Hills, which is not what you would think.
So, Susan, is it hit or miss all over the country?
Well, this is a complicated law laid on top of what was already a very complicated insurance system.
Right, right, right.
Well, other ways to look at it are as follows. We know that 80% of the people who have signed up on the marketplaces so far have been eligible for the premium tax credits. And for some people, that lowers the cost to zero. They pay zero premium to get coverage. So we'll have to see how all of this comes together when the final numbers are in.
And that's not Medicaid. That's people who
have
coverage.
That's people who have private coverage now through the exchanges but are paying zero premium, basically nothing, because they have substantial premium tax credits.
We know, Mary Agnes, there's been relentless criticism from Republicans. We're hearing it again today. They either want to repeal it or fix it, change it dramatically. What are you finding from ordinary folks? And I'm interested in hearing from both of you, what about the actual players, the healthcare providers, not just the insurance companies, but hospitals, doctors, and others? How are they feeling about it at this point?
People seem to like individual elements of the health law. For example, the polling has shown if you talk about no more annual limits, no more lifetime limits, people like that idea, keeping their adult child up to age 26 on their health insurance plan. But again, the problem comes in looking at the affordability, and it's really going to be a local story. We talk about this at the national level, and that makes sense, but it will depend on what is the risk pool, what are the premiums set at the local and the state levels as people look at this going forward.
How do you see it, Susan?
Well, it's variable again. The anecdotal evidence from some insurers are that they're feeling pretty good about the risk pool, that lots of younger people have signed up. It won't be true nationally. We'll see other insurers with different experiences in different parts of the country. Same thing with healthcare providers. If you're in an area where there isn't a lot of access to, say, good primary care, some of the community health centers are feeling very much under the gun and overrun because so many people now are getting coverage and presenting with illnesses that they've had for a long time and haven't gotten care for a long time.
And so in terms of the reaction of hospitals, doctors, nurses, it's really, it depends on where you are and what the structure, the healthcare structure is.
Very much so. It's a patchwork around the country.
You both have been covering this nonstop since last October and really even before. This today is an important milestone, Mary Agnes. What would you say the next measuring milestone is? What do we look for? What do you look for next here?
If people think it's a good thing for them, do they find, again, the coverage affordable? Can they get access to the providers they wanted? Some of these policies have fairly high copays, out-of-pocket cost deductibles, and so on. How does that play out? We've talked about how many people have paid their premium. The insurance industry is saying that's about at the 80% mark, which is the industry standard. But as this goes on, do people sign up for a premium and then decide, gosh, they just can't cut it. Maybe the subsidies don't help them enough. Maybe they do. I think it's really going to take a while to see this play out, to see if it works for people, if they think it's a good deal or not.
And we'll be looking at the next open enrollment period, November 15th through February 15th of next year, to see what the insurance premiums are in year two. Are the insurance premiums going to go up substantially? Are they going to be about the same? Long way between now and when we'll know the answer to that.
Well, I don't think anybody's watching it more closely than the two of you. We appreciate it. Susan Dentzer, Mary Agnes Carey.
Great to be with you, Judy.